I
Okay,
agree.
so we can move on to our first segment. This is about Adam and Eve. The
Right.
reason why I chose a lot of these, well, the reason why I chose some of these topics, like this one, for example, is because I spent 25 years as a born-again evangelical Christian, and it's like this is something they almost never talked about in church because they would say maybe it's controversial, but it's, but you know, I always thought, why should we be afraid of learning and the truth and all that? So what I'd like to do is challenge you on this, and I'd like you to challenge me also as you see fit for 10 minutes. We can have an even exchange here.
Sure.
You know, the way I, when it comes to the origins of humans, I think the way I see it, there's really only two choices. Either God made humans from scratch, or humans descended from other animals, whether that be theistic evolution or naturalistic evolution. But basically, it's evolution versus creation. There's descent versus made from scratch, you know, not descent. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, it's good enough.
So what would you, so if that was true, which end would you come down on?
Well, I'm not terribly dogmatic about it. Let me preface it with this. I'm not a scientist, so if we start getting into the nuances of evolution, I may not be able to do justice to that subject. But I have looked at some things, and I've maybe got some personal experience I can shine some light on it. But for me, I don't think that somebody has to, and I would say you don't have to take a literal view of the Bible, specifically Genesis, to believe in God or the God of the Bible even. And you certainly don't have to reject evolution to become a Christian. So in fact, I think Christians make a hermeneutic error when they take a literal view of the Bible, because that would require dismissing literary devices, for example, such as hyperbole, metaphor, allegory, and so on. So I think for me, there's something important on the front side to say that, you know, Bernie, you, and anyone else listening don't have to reject evolution to accept God of the Bible. With that said, I do tend to take to the Genesis account as a historic account, but I don't think that's a prerequisite. I believed in God and Jesus for about 2.5 years before I became a skeptic of evolution or you know, Darwinian evolution, as it were.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I do lean towards it being a historic account.
So do you think, are you one of those Christians that says evolution is unscientific, that there's no scientific evidence for it? And
I wouldn't go that far. I would say that there are problems with the theory. I've looked at some of that. I'll tell you, for example, what happened with me, and you may find this story kind of funny, but so I became a believer. I'd been an agnostic and a proponent of evolution my whole life, and so then I became a believer. And you know, my wife, for example, was you know raised to believe in you know more like a young Earth creationism, for example. And so I'm not proud of this, but even as after I became a you know follower of Christ or a Christian, whatever you want to call it, I would still kind of make fun of her for those beliefs, and you know, I never really gave them any kind of credence, just because it was against everything I had been raised to believe. So all of a sudden, I find myself attending this Bible college, and I see that I'm in this strange situation where it looks like I'm going to have to take a class on creation science. And so I'm, you know, maybe a skeptic and a contrarian by nature. So what I did was I said, well, fine, if I'm going to have to take this class, I'm going to learn everything I can about evolution and debunk this teacher and make him look like a fool. So, again, I'm not proud of my motives in these things. But so I did that, and I started to look into evolution, and I found that there were a lot of problems with the theories. And so that just started unraveling maybe some of the presuppositions that I had had about it.
Do you think you can mention what do you think one of those problems are for evolution?
Yeah, sure. Well, I think there were really some ethical issues. I watched some documentaries on it, and one of the things that really stuck out to me was the recurring ethical failure of the scientific communities, where there was like this pre-commitment to evolution, And it seemed almost like a religious or a dogmatic approach. And you see over and over again where they're like trying to prove this thing. And it seems, now, it wasn't as non-emotional as I would have hoped to see. There was the historical use of bad science where it seemed like I'm watching these documentaries. And
oh, you mean
use,
like the Expelled movie?
No. Well, yeah, you could go into that also, into kind of, you know, forcing creationists out of the conversation and stuff like that. But I mean actually the history of the, like, the development of the theory of evolution. When, you know, even before Darwin, but then Darwin and then following that, there was, you know, where there would be false models that would come up and then people would come in and say they'd really push those models, and then they'd find out, right, oh, that's no good.
Okay, but I guess one thing, yeah, I would ask you about, I mean, like, for me, when I was a Christian, I think the first, there's two pieces of evidence that convinced me. I was a Christian, evangelical Christian, for over 25 years, and
right,
I grew up as a Catholic, and as a Catholic, we kind of took the Bible kind of metaphorically, didn't really take it serious, that, you know, this is, of course, there's not a real, yeah, Adam and Eve kind of thing. And then I became, right, a born-again evangelical Christian, and, you know, I went the other extreme, kind of like you, where now I'm in this group of people, and they take Adam literally and Noah literally and all this stuff. So I tried to believe like a young earther, but didn't really get there, and I had other Christians that show me around that I went to the next level up, which is the old earth creationist. But then, right, I saw the evidence for evolution, and I accepted evolution, and so then I was an evolutionary Christian. But for me, the reason why I had to accept evolution was primarily two arguments. One is a pseudogene argument, and the other one is the fused number two human chromosome. Are you aware of that one?
I know the pseudogenes a little bit, but no, I'm not aware of the chromosome.
Yeah, this is what this fused human chromosome number two, this was a central feature. You can look up Kenneth Miller on YouTube of the Dover trial over ID. So basically what happens is we have one less chromosome pair than, for example, chimps and orangutans. And what happens was, if you take two, like the chimp 2A and 2B, and combine it, you can see that's one of our chromosomes. And the reason why you know that was combined is because at the end of chromosomes, there's called telomeres, and the center, there's called a centromere. And so where these two combined, we had these vestigial telomeres in the middle, and there's also a vestigial centromere. So it's kind of obvious these merged. And so therefore, it makes it obvious there's some kind of connection there with the chimps as our cousins. And to me, it doesn't make any sense to say that we were made from scratch, because why would you make something from scratch with that, with vestigial DNA? Cool. And then the person I talked to last time, Fazel Rana, I noticed on Reasons to Believe, he wrote an article about this, and he doesn't accept evolution, but he did not deny this. He basically said, well, maybe God made humans by messing around with the existing DNA in this way. But to me, I find that unsatisfying, because it makes it look like there was dissent, which I think would make God look like a deceiver. So.
Sure. So, yeah, again, that would be what I was warning about on the front side, where this would be out of my expertise and something I probably couldn't do justice to in conversation.
You know,
as far as that goes, so.
I mean, to me, I see the reason why people usually reject evolution is because they just say that, well, you know, life is so complex, it's just too hard to imagine it happened. But when I see these kind of evidences, I agree that life is complex, it's amazing, the microbiology and all that is amazing, it's amazing, it's mind-blowing. But when you have this kind of evidence, I figure you have to accept this evidence, even though we can't understand how it happened. I mean, evolution, there's two parts of evolution. One is there's a fact that it happened, and then there's a theory that tries to explain that fact. And I see those as two different things. A theory of evolution, which is constantly being revised. There's kind of new methods, and, like, for example, horizontal gene transfer is another mechanism. So there's all kinds of mechanisms besides just mutation and random mutation and descent, but natural selection. There's other things too, but and those are the things we're trying to figure out. But it seems like the fact that it actually happened, I think, is a fact. So, I mean,
right.
I...
Yeah, so... Oh, go ahead.
I would... I read a little bit of your... I saw a little bit of your book on Amazon.com. I saw some of the text there, and it almost seemed like you were implying that evolution was kind of like what the atheists... You made it sound like that's what the atheists... I don't know, you didn't make it sound very, you didn't seem very accepting of Christians that would accept evolution. But you would say that that's incorrect, that you do accept Christians that?
Well, I don't know, for starters, I don't know actually what you're referring to, where I wrote about that. I don't remember writing about that specifically. But to the question itself, I think that you can be a Christian and believe in evolution. When I look at Scripture, I find it close to, if not completely inconsistent with it, when you really dig into it. But so I guess I just don't think that you need to presuppose, or like you cannot accept Christ without rejecting evolution is mm-hmm. what I'm kind of saying on that.
Yeah. Well, I guess, you know, I would say that's why I left the faith, is because I saw the fact of evolution. But like you said, if you look at Genesis, I think it's obvious it was written as a historical account because it's given genealogies. You wouldn't, if Adam is a figurative person, you wouldn't put him in a genealogy. So it's obviously these people thought he was a historical person. And personally, I just thought the two cannot be reconciled. And so I thought it made more sense to leave the faith. Over that, I mean, that was one of the reasons.
Yeah, see, that's man, there's just so much when you start looking back, like you talked about, you know, there's facts, there's things we can look at and observe, but when you start going into the process of distinguishing those things, you know, it gets pretty fuzzy, and that's where I really started to have a problem with some of the ethics that I saw being used in the scientific field. And I would include now, I was speaking specifically before about the historic development. I mean, so I'll give you an example. I'm watching this documentary, and there were a couple things that really stood out to me. One was there was this underlying religious tone to it, even though it was a secular documentary about evolution, you know, where the cover of the documentary was the Michelangelo, where Adam and God are reaching towards one another, and they had replaced God with an ape. And I'm like, why is that necessary? Why are you making a religious statement in a scientific documentary? But then there were other things where, like, so they go through the whole lineage or the whole history of the development of evolutionary theory, and they keep talking about Neanderthals, and they even go so far as to show, I would call this almost social engineering, but they go so far as to show these really intricate narratives where they have these Neanderthals interacting with humans, and then they say the humans came in and wiped out the Neanderthals. And then at the very end of the documentary, they say that, I think it was a German geneticist determined that Neanderthals couldn't have even been in the same lineage as humans because of the genetic differentiation.
Yeah, well, from my understanding, they say there was some mixing with Neanderthals. There's like 5% or so. I think Fazel Rana, who I talked to last time, he doesn't accept evolution, but he accepts there was some mixing there, I'm pretty sure.
I don't remember him saying that. That may be true, though. But anyway, so my point is that there's a lot of the things that are presented as a unified front, when you really start digging into it, you find out that there's not nearly as much synergy, maybe, as you would expect to find within some of those evolutionary theories.
But, you know, I guess one problem I have with what you're saying, though, is... when it comes down to evolution, is it true or not? It comes down to what is the evidence for it? And it sounds like when you're saying you don't accept evolution because of the social issues, that's not looking at the facts of it. That's looking at the consequences of it. And you
I have looked at the evidence, but again, what happens is you've got some really high level skilled scientists on both sides of the argument who are interpreting the data through different lenses. And you can go back and forth into eternity, and I think that's ultimately a healthy process because it, to some degree, keeps everyone honest and challenges their ways of thinking. But I'm not particularly a scientist in that. Like, on my list of things that I'm particularly that I care about on a high level, whether or not, you know, macroevolution, whether or not there's species jumps and things like that, or massive mutations within a DNA structure, that doesn't influence so much how I'm going to live out my life and how I'm going to influence people. So I just let other people handle that right now, and I look into it. I'm maybe it's a hobby to look into those things, but it's not something I'm going to spend my life researching every new paper that comes out. I'm just going to put that one on the back burner because, like I said, to me, really, even I would suggest that having you and I having this conversation about interpretation of Genesis is out of place in a sense. It's kind of putting the cart before the horse. I would look at that as more of an internal apologetic conversation where, you know, Christians who do believe in the authenticity of the Bible or maybe the reliability of the Bible can speak to one another and say, well, this is how I interpret it, this is how I interpret it. But the fact that there are so many Christians on, you know, across, you've got a lot of Christians who are young earth, a lot of, you know, you've got the Reasons to Believe guys, you know, who are old earth but not evolution. Then you've got the evolutionary Christians. So you've got this wide breadth of interpretation, and everyone has their own way of interpreting the scripture through the science. And to me, it's just, you know, you're going to end up coming back to, well, ultimately, we don't have the final answer, but we can kind of guess around at it and get some really good ideas. But I've seen successful arguments on all ends, and it's just not where I've, yeah, I mean, like I said, I've only started looking into these things in the last 4 years. So I have to kind of, pick and choose what I'm going to really pour my heart into. And so I'm more interested in things like ethics and how to function as a culture and a community.
Right.
Not necessarily. And I'm not knocking the science. It's super important. I just personally haven't gotten into a very high level of it. And it's not going to, if I was to turn around tomorrow and say, I believe in evolution, that's not going to change the way I live my life so much.
Actually, it could. I mean, for me, that's the reason why I left the faith. I mean, if you were to accept evolution, you may come to the conclusion like I did that Genesis, that all that is a myth, and then you have to reinvent it. And then once you go down the path of evolution and how the stars were formed through cosmic evolution, I mean, it's kind of a snowball effect that it would, I guess, you know, in technical terms or academic terms, it's, you know, your hermeneutics. It would affect your hermeneutics on how you see everything in the Bible.
But there are other things. My only evidence isn't whether or not I have, I'm not going to reject the Bible because of one interpretation of the Genesis account is what I'm saying. So even if I found out that macroevolution was 100% true, it's not going to change whether or not I believe the entirety of the Bible is reliable. It would just change maybe how I would interpret Genesis 1.
Well, for me, it was about half of it. The other half was neurology, which we don't have on our agenda today. But I wanted to mention, too, you said like there's experts on all that disagree about this. But from my perspective, if you look at, you know, every state has, like in Oregon here, we have two public universities. We have the University of Oregon and Oregon State University. So some states have more than one public university. And as I understand it, every single state university teaches evolution in science, for the origins of humans, et cetera. And not one of them would teach creation science. And so I think it's untrue to say that, well, there's people in science who disagree, you know, both sides. I don't think that's a true statement when you look at practicing biological scientists. I mean,
I would actually take that the other way, and I would say that what you're looking at is would be a bent away from true science, because you're not allowed to really get into creationism in those environments. It's what we're doing is I look at indoctrination as a given. We're going to get indoctrinated one way or another, and so the school system right now is perpetuating an evolutionary perspective. And so
why is that?
I would call it a political thing. I mean,
that's where we would disagree. I think it's because of the science. But
well, I know some really skilled doctors. I know pilots. I know physicists. I know cosmologists, biologists who believe in creation, a non-evolutionary perspective of creation.
But you know, if they're a doctor, it wouldn't matter. I mean, doctors aren't experts in, they're not PhDs. I mean, if you said you had people with PhDs in biology that rejected evolution, that would mean something. But mentioning pilots and doctors and other lawyers and stuff.
You don't think there's any PhD biologists that reject evolution?
There are some, but I would probably say it's less than 1%. It's probably like half of a percent or something. It's very small. It's insignificant.
That's probably true, but the system is not set up to allow for any dissent, no pun intended.
Okay. All right, shall we go on to the next one?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay, let's talk about Noah's Ark.